Welcome. My name is Rasim Dragunov. I teach in the Russian Studies Department here. My task is to welcome you all here and introduce very briefly the panel. This is the third event, or fourth maybe, event the Jordan Center is organizing this week. And there are two more to go. So it's we would say in Russian, we are boiling with activity. But what makes this event special is that it was conceived of, organized, and to a large extent attended by the Russian club at NYU, by students here. And I'll very briefly, have Olga Reichardt, the chair of this club, speak and say a few words about the Russian club. So,
much for attending this event. So the Russian club has been at NYU for longer than 10 years, and we as students are just very happy to be continuing this tradition of bringing the cultural and political discussion of and about Russia to NYU, to students and to the faculty of NYU. So we are extremely privileged today to have our speakers, and big thanks to the Jordan Center and to the Department of the Russian Slavic Studies at NYU. Without them, this would never have been possible. Thank you so much, and please enjoy.
Thank you. There might be a lot of clapping, but the topic of today's panel is beyond political games, and it is on the Russo-Ukrainian conflict. In my experience, this is a topic that often that doesn't really encourage meaningful dialogue for the most part. Which is precisely why it's important to try. Because there was, of course, Russian intervention, most explicitly in the annexation of Crimea. And in a much more hidden, insidious way in Lugansk and Donetsk. But there is also an element of a civil war. And in any civil war, the two sides would have their very legitimate grievances and would often try to out-shout each other without listening. And this is what this panel will hopefully do. I'm supposed to be the moderator, so my task is to keep the conversation moderate. And I'm very hopeful that with the lineup of very distinguished lineup of speakers we have, we will achieve this moderation. So starting on my very left. We are joined by Peter Zalmayev, who is the director of the Eurasian Democracy Initiative, an international non-profit organization dedicated to the promotion of democracy and human rights in the post-communist transitional societies of Eastern Europe, Central Asia, and the Caucasus. Mr. Zalmayev managed the Central Asia and the Caucasus program at the League for Human Rights, a major international watchdog between 2000 and 2006. Most relevantly for our panel, in June and July 2014, he was in Kiev and various other places in Ukraine, where he appeared in leading Ukrainian broadcast media. And the country's main political TV show, Schuster Live, where he urged Ukraine's government to devise a broad international media campaign to help Ukraine in the face of the Russian intervention. He's also given numerous interviews on the Russo-Ukrainian conflict, Kramatskaya TV, Vesti Radio, and BBC, Ukraine's CNN, and Al Jazeera. In the middle of the panel is Lucan, who comes to us all the way from Toronto, where he's an associate professor of political science. At the University of Toronto, he teaches and researches democratic transitions and the evolution of authoritarian rule in the former Soviet Union from a cross-regional perspective. And all his books are extremely relevant to our to today's topic. His first one, Competitive Authoritarianism, Hybrid Regimes After the Cold War, was published in 2010 at Cambridge University Press. His new book, forthcoming from Johns Hopkins.
Already published.
My information is already okay. Pluralism by Default examines Greek autocracies and the rise of competitive politics in the region. And he's already conceived of and started writing a new one, the durability of revolutionary regimes. Already? No.
Not yet.
About why regimes such as the Soviet Union, Cuba, Iran, and Korea have proven so resilient in the face of international pressure. And our founding, and our last speaker, to an extent, you know, the host of this gathering, you know, is Yanni Kotsonis, who is the founding director of the Jordan Center for the Study of Russia at NYU, and a professor of history here. He was educated in Athens, Montreal, Copenhagen, London, Moscow, and New York. And I'm sure the list could be extended. He's been a very prolific commentator of events that have to do with Russia and its surroundings. And has published two widely decorated books, Making Peasants Backward, on the agricultural question in late Imperial Russia, and States of Obligation, his recent monograph on taxation and citizenship in late Empire and the early Soviet Union. Each of the speakers, who have approximately 15, 20 minutes to speak, after which we'll turn to the audience. Thank you.
I guess I'll go first. And I'll just start by saying that the fundamental issue that we need to understand as we approach the question of the history of Russia-Ukraine relations, their past, their present, and their future, is that the Russians, or more specifically Russian political elites, have never been able to come to terms with the very entity, the very polity of Ukraine as fully separate, fully autonomous, fully independent of an agent ever since Bogdan Khmelnytsky's signing of the Union Treaty with Russia in mid-17th century. And that denial of agency has extended to Ukraine's borders, its very ethnic identity categorization, its language. The latter two were called under the Tsarist Russia as Malorossia or Malorosskaya Narechie, which is to say Little Russia, Little Russians, and the language was referred to as Little Russian. So Ukrainians were accorded at best the status of an ethnic Russian subgroup, and the Ukrainian language that of a southern regional dialect. And for reference, I would direct you to one of the great classics of Russian literature, Nikolai Gogol's Taras Bulba, where Ukraine is referred to as Ukraina or Ukraine on many fewer occasions than as Rus, which is part of the original Kievan Rus, that stem that became eventually embedded in the name of Russia. Most of you probably remember that oft-quoted remark, supposedly unscripted remark, that Vladimir Putin made in his conversation with George W. Bush when he referred to Ukraine as, when he said that Ukraine is not even a country. And you probably have heard that, you remember it, but I think it's very important and it bears repeating because it encapsulates quite laconically Big Brother Russia's dismissive attitude about Ukraine's project of statehood. In fact, speaking of cultural integration between the two countries, which is the stated title of today's panel is a moot point, I think, since on the one hand you have a unitary state, Ukraine, and on the other you have the heir to the Tsarist and then Soviet empires, with many skeptical Russian observers referred to as a недораспавшаяся империя, which is to say essentially an imperial project whose disintegration process has been temporarily halted, only to resume, as they believe, at some point in the near future with painful consequences for all. Let's take a look at these two countries separately. The driving ideological force in Putin's Russia has increasingly been this Versailles-type resentment over the perceived short end of the stick that Russia got as it was at the end of the Cold War, which has in turn begotten isolationism and historical revisionism in Russia. The processes that have accelerated at various points in Russia's recent history, I would point out, for example, Putin's belligerent speech at the Munich Security Conference in 2007, then the reaction to America's wars in the Middle East and Afghanistan, and following the Sochi Olympics and the decision to annex the Crimea, and then the war in the eastern Ukraine which followed. Therefore, Vladimir Putin's chief goal has been, in my opinion, the recreation in a different guise and according to new circumstances of Russia's imperial glory, with all of its requisite goals, chief of them, the spreading of its indirect influence over the region, but also more directly territorial expansion, which was exemplified in the annexation of Crimea. The man himself, in fact, has gone on record characterizing, as you remember, the fall of the Soviet Union as one of, in fact, the greatest geopolitical catastrophe of the 20th century. This sort of drive for influence has included cultivation of vassal states such as Belarus under President Lukashenko, to a lesser extent Armenia, and also creating various regional alliances, including the short-lived Guam, and finally, and most ominously for its neighbors, and especially in the past 2 years, as you have seen for Ukraine, it's been this carving out, taking chunks out of the territory of states on the periphery, former parts of the Soviet Union, that are perceived by Russia as disloyal. And just to cite some examples, these are Transnistria in Moldova, Abkhazia and South Ossetia in Georgia. We may even be able to include in this group Azerbaijan's Nagorno-Karabakh, currently under Armenia's occupation, with Russia's active acquiescence. And finally, most recently and most bloodily, this is Ukraine's eastern provinces of Donetsk and Luhansk, known collectively as the Donbass. And if any more empirical evidence is needed for this imperial, for the fact of the imperial reconstruction project, then I'd direct you to listen to the most recent version of the Russian anthem, the music for which was transplanted directly from the Soviet one early in the Putin's presidency in 2000, I believe, while the text was written by the nonagenarian Sergei Mikhalkov, author of the previous two Soviet versions of the anthem. And one of the lines of this current incarnation refers to Russia as centuries-old union of brotherly peoples. Now with Ukraine, for the past 20 years of its post-Soviet independent existence, Ukraine has struggled with divergent perceptions of history, including World War II. Those divergent perceptions have diverged along the River Dnieper. We have the eastern Ukraine, we have the west. So the east-west divide, which, according to which, you know, the history of World War II was respectively interpreted as that of the War of Liberation against the Nazi occupiers in the east, while in the west, folks treated some of its own liberation heroes, whom the East has referred to as and considers as Nazi collaborators, and have adopted them as national heroes. So the very history has been contested, and various political groups, the political elites, the Russian language political elites, the Ukrainian language political elites, have used these hot button issues, historical issues, for their own, to advance their own agenda. But I would have to just, you know, note one a very important fact underlying this contestation that we witnessed in the 20 years of Ukraine's independence is that Ukraine, for that whole time, was a peaceful and stable country. As contested, as corrupt as it was not until Vladimir Putin decided to send his green men to the Crimea, to the Crimean Peninsula, with the ensuing annexation, ostensibly in response to the events or the disorder of the Maidan, that it was not until then that Ukraine became embroiled in a bloody conflict between, you can argue, its two parts. Putin kicked, after the annexation of Crimea, Putin went into overdrive, with his propaganda efforts to teach Ukrainians to hate. To plant the idea that Ukrainians, Western Ukrainians, are heirs to the Nazi collaborator Stepan Bandera, and fifth columnist in the service of the West, tying in with his overarching doctrine that the latter has been hell-bent on Russia's encirclement and disintegration in order to plunder its wealth. And the Crimea scenario has failed miserably in the Donbass, along with Putin's doctrine of Novorossiya, New Russia. Originally, it was designed to encompass a wide crescent of Ukraine's territory stretching from the north, northeast, the Kharkiv region, the Donbass, Kherson, and all the way down to the Odessa, effectively leaving Ukraine a landlocked state. And what we see now, 2 years after, it is the Novorossiya project has been limited to a rump little statelet comprised of two areas surrounding the cities of Luhansk and Donetsk. These areas have largely been are now saddled with destroyed infrastructure. Folks there have been living on the dole, and large folks from the Donbass have largely voted with their feet. As a result of the start of the hostilities, they left in droves to live elsewhere in Ukraine, or like my own family that hails from Donetsk, elsewhere, and only a minority of them have chosen to live in Russia. Most of the Russian speakers in this so-called territory of Novorossiya, in fact, have continued to prefer the use of their native Russian language. And at the same time, they have rejected the idea of quitting Ukraine in order to join this Novorossiya project. Once again, I think especially notable here is Russian propaganda's role in driving a wedge between the two nations. Probably at least, I think, for a generation. And here I would direct you to consider Peter Pomerantsev's recent report, well, it's about 2 years now, The Menace of Unreality, How the Kremlin Weaponizes Information Culture and Money. It's a veritable anatomy of Russian propaganda and is very instructive. And it talks not only about propaganda inside Russia for domestic purposes, but more importantly, the way Putin has been able to mobilize some of its propaganda tools to target Western audiences, and specifically Western Europe. So from the crucified babies of Slavyansk to dredging up old ghosts of anti-Semitism, it is clear that Russia is not really interested in reintegration on equal terms with its brotherly Ukrainian nation, having slandered them as fascists, as anti-Semites, and as Washington lackeys to boot. It is interested in Ukrainians really coming begging and at their wits' end, at their crumbling economy. And I think the fact is that the Euromaidan of 2013 was different from the previous ones in that it was a civic activist and state-building exercise rather than a narrowly ethnically defined resurgence. Let me just mention the fact that the ethnic Jewish oligarch, one of the most prominent businessmen in Ukraine, Mr. Kolomoisky, in fact, masterminded the defense of Ukraine's front line, having been able to prevent the menace of separatism from spreading further. And Maidan was a multi-ethnic and multi-lingual affair. Then I would also like to cite the volunteer efforts by folks in the east, in the city of Mariupol, that likewise prevented more of Ukraine's territory from being overrun. It created a funny precedent. Well, the Ukrainians joked and came up with this term of Judeo Banderovtsi. I'm not sure if you've heard this. I loosely translated it as Judeo Banderovites, or Russian-speaking Banderovites. So essentially you have, in Mr. Kolomoisky, a Jew and a Nazi sympathizer at once. So basically that puts a line to Russia's propaganda efforts to paint Ukrainians as intolerant, as anti-Semitic, as anything but people yearning for, you know, for an agency, I think, and to live their lives they want to live. But in parallel to that, I think, and as a reaction to Putin's propaganda, the idea of Euromaidan has, it has to be admitted, has been diluted by elements of nationalism and jingoism and Russophobia, which have likewise been catalysts for the forging of a strong, newly assertive Ukrainian identity. There have been both positive and negative trends in that. And you know, among the negative trends, we see sort of a moving away from the stated goal of Euro integration, when we see LGBT pride rallies being attacked, as we've seen in Kyiv and in Lviv. We have seen a resurgence of nationalism in certain parts of Ukraine, still largely, I would posit, a marginal phenomenon. But on the other hand, we have a veritable cultural renaissance in Ukraine with an increased literary output, an output in visual arts. We have a resurgence of a strong identity, and you can see it for yourselves just by visiting Ukraine, by walking down the Ukrainian, you know, city streets and seeing ladies wearing ethnic garb, these beautiful flower wreaths, something that you had never seen before. It's quite unprecedented. And I think still, with all of these caveats, I think, the Euro orientation, the European pro-democracy orientation of Ukraine remains strong. In fact, prompting George Soros, time and again in his column in the New York Review of Books and other publications, to make an argument that the European Union needs Ukraine more than vice versa. It's that injection of idealistic kind of blood that Ukraine can provide that Europeans need so sorely. So in fact, what can Russia offer Ukraine, a unitary state? Only a kind of, I think, post-Soviet imperialist project with its own myriad of ethnic autonomies, including the Chechen fiefdom of its medievally thuggish president Ramzan Kadyrov, who fulfills his grand bargain with Moscow by receiving bags of money in return for keeping a lid on the simmering violence in Chechnya, and also providing mercenaries to fight in various hotspots, including, as we've seen recently, to fight in eastern Ukraine. Remember that even under the Soviets, the West often referred to the entire USSR, which was comprised, as it was, of 15 ostensibly equal partners, Soviet republics, and 22 so-called ethnic autonomies, as simply Russia. And so we're talking about the perspectives of, if we're talking about the perspectives of political reintegration between the two countries, I would say that it's a non-starter for at least a generation, or even more. But if we're talking about cultural integration, and if by culture we mean political culture, then there has indeed been a dialogue between the two countries, but it's been largely in one direction. I'm talking about Russia's Democrats, Russian TV personalities, journalists who have had to flee Putin's Russia in this climate of xenophobia, in this climate of witch hunts that we see now. You've been seeing them in Kyiv, you've been seeing them on talk shows. One of the high-profile TV journalists, Evgeny Kisilov, who has been for years a talk host at a major political talk show. Mr. Ilya Ponomarev, who is Russian Parliament's most liberal member, the only member, in fact, who voted against the annexation of Crimea, has been a frequent guest of Ukrainian TV stations, and most recently it was Matvey Gonopolsky, another high-profile journalist who's now got his own TV show in Ukraine. And don't forget that Boris Nemtsov was also a very frequent guest of Ukraine, a frequent visitor, an unofficial advisor to the Ukrainian government, frequent guest on the Ukrainian TV, having been banished from Russian airwaves. So the fundamental difference between the two countries is that with all its myriad problems, its fractious oligarchy, and its moniker as one of Europe's most corrupt states, as The Guardian recently put, Ukraine is still a democracy, paradoxically, however imperfect it may be, while Russia under Vladimir Putin has modeled its governance after that of Pinochet's Chile. Ukrainians are currently in the process of what they think of as reclaiming their European identity away from the increasingly despotic, un-European, or the way it is often caricatured in Ukraine, Asiatic model of governance that Putin's Russia offers. So will Ukraine become part of the European political project as a member of the EU? Will it be fully and finally accepted by the Europeans as a European country? Probably not anytime soon. But for Ukraine, there's probably never going back under Russia's embrace, where it has languished for the past 300 years. Just to cite some stark figures here, the proportion of those with positive attitudes towards Russia decreased from 80% in January 2014 to 50% in September of 2014. In November 2013, a third of Ukrainians wanted membership in the EU, and a year later, that figure grew twice to 64%. So instead, I think Ukraine will always remain, or for the foreseeable future, will remain what it has always been. And that is the gates of Europe, as is the title of a recent book by a professor of Ukrainian studies at Harvard, Serhii Plokhii. Therefore, I think it will remain neither fully with Russia nor with Europe. And in closing, I'd like to just read a quote from that wonderful book, which I also highly commend to you to read. The title of the book, The Gates of Europe, is of course a metaphor, but not one to be taken lightly or dismissed as a marketing gimmick. Europe is an important part of the Ukrainian story, as Ukraine is part of the European one. Located at the western edge of the Eurasian steppe, Ukraine has been a gateway to Europe for many centuries. Sometimes when the gates were closed as a result of wars and conflict, Ukraine helped stop foreign invasions east and west. When they were open, as was the case for most of Ukraine's history, it served as a bridge between Europe and Eurasia, facilitating the interchange of people, goods, and ideas. Thank you.
Well, I have to stand up because
Slideshow.
Hold on,
it's right there.
Let's go to slideshow.
Yeah, there you go.
There
you go. All right, great. So last time I gave this talk, I got booed in Wizard Toronto, so get ready. You're like, what's going to be this talk? Well, I was booed at the University of Toronto, where there's a large Ukrainian diaspora. So so basically, what I want to talk about today is Euromaidan, very similar topic. Peter was nice, he really focused out from the Russian perspective. I'm going to talk about it much more from the domestic Ukrainian perspective. And basically the puzzle is sort of understanding why something like this, Euromaidan, which was, as mentioned, as Peter mentioned, a very spontaneous, initially peaceful protest against autocracy, rapidly turned into this, which is a war between Russia and Ukraine. I think this was completely unexpected to everyone, and I think it was, I argue, inherently unpredictable. And basically, I want to look at this conflict, as has been mentioned in the intro, it's been highly polarizing, and you have two very different perspectives on what happened. And I want to say there are problems with both, a lot more problems with the Russian perspective, but still both. So basically, we have two versions. One is the Ukrainian version, seeing Euromaidan as a popular revolt uniting Ukraine behind integration with Europe, undermined by an inherently expansionist Russia. Now, I think there's certain elements of truth to this, but there are also problems with this. The other perspective, which is the Russian perspective, sees Euromaidan as a Western-led fascist coup followed by an uprising in the East, caused by Russians fighting discrimination by the new government and new fascist government in Kiev. And basically, I argue there are problems with both. The Russian version is undeniably further from the truth. The Ukrainian version is problematic for two reasons. Basically, Ukraine prior to the crisis was not, in fact, united behind Europe. And I think Russia is not inherently expansionist. In other words, the invasion was not inevitable. From the Russian perspective, there was really no reason. The invasion was completely unprovoked. In fact, the government, there was no discrimination against Russians. The post-Yanukovych government was far from fascist and very moderate. And the Russian invasion completely unprovoked. Okay. So basically, to understand the war in Ukraine, you have to understand two things. First is that you have a newly aggressive expansionist Russia under Putin. And then you have the Euromaidan, which was had a very important regional element, which I think, in the sense that it reflected divisions between East and West Ukraine that Peter talked about, and more importantly, caused a fundamental breakdown of the state in early 2014, which basically created an opening for Putin to march in and cause a lot of trouble. So we really have to understand the regional element, not the unifying element of the movement, to understand the crisis. Euromaidan, the war with this is, I don't know if anybody of you know what a black swan is. It's something that never happens. It's very rare, completely unpredictable. This was the war and Euromaidan were both sort of, would argue, black swan events. That, you know, I'm a social scientist, we're supposed to predict things. This, I think, was, I got it wrong, so I'm just trying to make an excuse for why I got it wrong. So social scientists aren't doing that well. No one predicted Trump. No one's predicting this, so this is, we're feeling a little bit defensive these days, so I blame it on the swan. Okay, so, basically Ukraine under Yanukovych, President Viktor Yanukovych came to power, was elected in 2010, in 2013 is invited to sign the European Association Agreement. He refuses, there's a protest, but he actually is quite strong. He's basically, before the crisis, had no opposition, has a solid majority in parliament, and protests, you know, it's just not clear that they'll ever succeed, which is exactly when I published that Yanukovych would be in power until 2016, and it turns out he wasn't. So I guess don't trust anything I say in this presentation, because I've gotten everything else wrong. So basically I want to know, why is this unexpected revolution, unexpected war, where did this come from? Well, you know, just because it can't predict it doesn't mean it doesn't have causes, doesn't mean it isn't a reflection of history. And the first thing I think to understand is this map, which many of you who study Ukraine are sick of. I just gave a presentation of this in Berkeley, and someone told me that it was immoral to present this map because it's too memorable. Yes, it's reductionism, yes, it's a simplification, but that's what we do as political scientists, we reduce and simplify. And basically what you had in Ukraine, this is before 2014, is basically a stark cultural difference between East and West Ukraine that was not ethnic. It was much more like red states and blue states in the United States. You know, that was really the profound cultural differences. I lived in Eastern Ukraine. I also spent a lot of time in Western Ukraine. Basically, in the West, you have a language which is overwhelmingly Ukrainian and a very much of a Western foreign policy orientation. In the East, you have primarily Russophone, although ethnic Ukrainian, and a foreign policy orientation primarily towards Russia and anti-EU and anti-NATO. Initially, you know, I think stupid people in the CIA thought this would lead to civil war. It did not. And in fact, as Peter mentioned, Ukraine was very peaceful, yet very corrupt. About the 1990s and the 2000s. Basically, Western Ukraine became sort of the Galicia under Austrian rule in the 19th century. Ukrainian culture was promoted, identifies very strongly with Europe. This is Western Ukraine is very much the center of Ukrainian nationalism. And during World War II, symbolism becomes very important, so I'm going to make a small divergence. Ukrainian nationalists, as Peter mentioned, organization of Ukrainian nationalism, allied with the Nazis, were involved in ethnic cleansing, and they had the flag, the red and black flag, and they were led for a time by this guy, Stepan Bandura, who was also mentioned by Peter. Okay, so this is sort of exists as a symbol which is very popular in the West, not so popular in the East, in fact, hated in the East. So this is. So, East, much longer since 17th century, under the Russian Empire, very much Russophone. This is a minor, very dirty. This is ethnically Ukrainian, but Russian speaking. Okay, so, Again, Ukraine was did not have, contrary to expectations in the 90s, which were largely shaped by the Yugoslav War, did not have it. It had no far-right party. It was like the only country in Europe with no far-right party. Oh my God, no violence, no ethnic, you know, very peaceful, again, but very corrupt, whatever. Okay, so what happened? You know, what happened in 2014, what I'm about to tell you. Okay, so first, what happened in the 2000s is you have an increasingly self-confident Russia, which is bent on expansion. In the 1990s, Yeltsin is very nice. He lets the whole empire go, doesn't really do anything about it. However, oil prices increases, and Russian calls to annex Crimea also increase. When I lived in Moscow in the early 1990s, long before this, the favorite phrase, you know, whenever you talk about Crimea was Krim nash, Crimea is ours. So to me, you know, this was all my friends, my liberal friends, thought that Crimea was part of Russia. And indeed, Putin, you know, there's unambiguously, you know, invaded Crimea, and he also has been heavily involved in helping sponsor the separatists in eastern Ukraine. But it's important, I think, to emphasize this was not inevitable. Many irredentist claims by governments in history go, you know, unfulfilled. You know, Hungary's claims on Transylvania, Austria's claims on South Tyrol. And whether, you know, just because the government wants to do it doesn't mean it's going to happen. And in fact, what we know that he wanted to take Crimea, but we don't know what cost he was willing to undergo in order to invade. And that's the unknown, right? Just because you say, you know, I want a, you know, a Mercedes Benz, but it doesn't necessarily mean I'm going to spend all my savings to get that Mercedes Benz, right? You know, like, you know, if it involves a high cost, so this is unknowable. So, and indeed, some predicted he would invade Crimea. No one predicted that he would move into Donbass. Now, so how did this happen? First of all, again, Yanukovych refuses to sign the European Association Agreement. In response, you have mass protests in throughout, especially Western Ukraine and Kiev. This was incredibly spontaneous. I mean, there were no prefabricated signs, and this is me with a silly hat during the protests. This is my very sophisticated Canadian hat, my friends of mine at the barricades. This is me with a informal militiaman at this camp they set up near Armaidan in Kiev. It was a very exciting time. This was sort of the peaceful, exciting period. I left, and then things went south. I don't think that was, you know, I think it's pure coincidence, but yeah. What do you say? That's data, right? So to understand how it went south, and again, I want to be clear before, you know, you freak out at me. I'm saying how it happened. You know, I'm not saying the Ukrainian opposition has moral culpability for the invasion. The invasion is, you know, Putin was responsible for the invasion. I'm just saying why it happened and how it happened. And basically what you had is the protests demanding integration with Europe, and it was oftentimes referred to as, you know, as unifying Ukraine, but consistently, if you look at poll after poll, only not more than half, or just above half, supported integration with the European Union. I mean, this is not just one poll, many, many polls. And you know, Yanukovych himself was incredibly unpopular, but it's just undeniable that Ukraine was split between support for European Union. It was not a unifying issue. And furthermore, the protests themselves, while there were a lot of Russian speakers, it's true, were overwhelmingly from the West. This is one survey, 53% of protesters from Western Ukraine, 17% from Central Ukraine, to 3% from Eastern Ukraine. Right, so there's huge regional character. But what was different about this protest is that, in part because of the good stuff, because it was spontaneous and people just, you know, were allowed to express themselves, they relied on symbols which were highly polarizing and divisive. So the tragic irony, and this is that the demand of the protesters were completely peaceful. You know, there was not about, you know, ethnic purity. It was not about kicking Russians out at all. But they used these highly polarizing extremist symbols, the red and the black, and, you know, just in case you weren't paying attention, Are the same as that. So these are symbols that sort of have highly positive connotations in Western Ukraine, but are really inimical to Eastern Ukraine. And so really, so Russia calls this a fascist government. I say, well, it's a government that sort of had an epic, PR disaster. Right? I mean, really, and then what happens is you have the fall of Yanukovych. Yanukovych hangs on. He cracks down a little bit, not too much. You have the radicalization of the opposition, largely in response to the fact that Yanukovych refuses to compromise. On February 20th, you have snipers, government snipers, that kill about 86 people in the center of Kiev in the middle of daytime. The government completely collapses. Yanukovych is forced to flee, and you have this fundamental breakdown of the state, right? Throughout Eastern Ukraine especially, which in turn, I argue, basically made it possible for Putin to enter the scene. And then you have, it was an irregular transfer of power in the sense that you did not have a negotiation. Basically, there's this massive power vacuum. Opposition leader takes power. And this is also a critical mistake of the opposition. The Svoboda Party, which is a radical party by any definition, which participated very much in the protests, they take 5 seats in cabinet, including the prosecutor and the Ministry of Defense. I mean, these aren't like, ministry of paper that doesn't matter. I mean, this is like major positions in the government. And so, it's kind of confusing because you have like this new government which says, we're democratic, and they are democratic. This guy, Turchinov, who made them look corrupt, but very democratic. But then, this is confusing to people because you actually have these extremist parties in government. So, I say this and they're like, you're a Russian, Putin stooge. I wish I would get paid more money, but this is the case. And then basically, Putin has a field day with this. There was, in fact, no anti-Russian measures during the crisis. Many people argued that that the Russian language law was altered. That's not the case. That's a complete lie. Even pro-Ukrainians argued the Russian language law was rescinded. That actually never happened. It was voted on in parliament. Turchinov vetoed it. Okay. And what this contributes to, this sort of this breakdown of power, and the fact that the protesters unfortunately used very unfortunate symbolism associated with extremists, nationalist extremists, means that in Donbass in April, so you had this dichotomy. On one side, Donbass overwhelmingly wants to remain in Ukraine. But 70% of Donetsk and Luhansk saw the new government as illegal. In other words, as completely illegitimate, which again, combined with state collapse, creates this enormous soil for Putin to come in and make trouble. And then you have the Russians invade Crimea. There's almost no violence. Then in Donbass, in eastern Ukraine, you have these sort of, initially Ukrainians start spontaneously taking over provincial headquarters. What's interesting is that Dominique Aurel and others have done studies of this. The Russian involvement did not really seriously come until several weeks later. Without Putin, you would never have this war. But nonetheless, there is a strong domestic component. It's not simply an invasion, right? This raises the question. This is where I get in the most trouble. If you Google me, you'll see me arguing that this should be called a civil war. And then people throw spitballs at me and stuff, because the implication is that if I call it a civil war, I'm saying, Putin's not at fault. And it's really the Ukrainians themselves. It's a real question. Do you call it a civil war? I think empirically and from a social scientific perspective, there's a real reason to call it a civil war. If you call it a civil war, I agree with that. But I'm uncomfortable because to some people that implies that somehow, Putin's not at fault. But in the reality, the social science reality, is that almost all civil wars involve a huge foreign external element. So in this, Ukraine is not unique. And indeed, there's a huge polarization. And the question is, will it end? I think it basically will end when Putin wants it to. But again, to sort of end, basically, it was not a fascist coup. It was caused by power vacuum. And Russia was very much responsible for the war. But opportunity for Russian intervention was created by a state collapse and serious mistakes by the opposition. Thanks.
Thanks to the Russian Club for organizing this. They actually organized everything with our help. But we're always happy to work with them. They put together some wonderful ideas for events. And this one's particularly nice because it brings together people who normally not be together. And I'm here regularly, but we have two guests who I think gave wonderful talks and wonderful representations of what's going on. And I'm wondering, how can I be useful? How can I be useful? And what can I bring to the conversation we don't already know? Well, I'm a historian. I'm not Russian, I'm not Ukrainian. That doesn't absolve me of responsibility for what I say, but it gives me a different kind of investment. What I really care about as a historian is to try to figure out how our conversations came to be what they are now. And I repeat, why are we having these kinds of conversations about Russia and Ukraine? Why do we use certain toxic terms? Why do we keep using almost primordial definitions of each other when we're talking about Ukrainians and Russians? I have in mind, just in the course of today, these were wonderful talks, by the way. I'm not talking about the current speaker, but I'm talking about our general public conversation about Ukraine and Russia. And also it seeps into American politics, where our politicians use similar terminology. So just in a normal conversation about Russia and Ukraine, we're going to have something about fascists, Nazis, anti-Semites, genocidal maniacs, LGBT, Chechens, Putin, Bandera. What else have I missed? You know, sort of things that are intended, in other words, like to be toxic. I mean, they're meant to really not have a conversation. And I think that's one of the purposes of having this this panel, which is, you know, how can we actually have a conversation and not being polarized. Now, it's good to have disagreements. I don't have a problem with that. But I can tell you two kinds of stories right now. And one of them is my understanding of why it is we're having this kind of conversation about Ukraine and Russia, why it's become this polarized picture about Ukraine and Russia, because I don't accept that it needs to be told in those terms. And the other one is, what kind of histories could we tell? And the tendency is, in this latter conjecture, that we use history to say, you see, you're going back to Khmelnytsky, you're going back to Skarabatsky, you know, whoever it is that you want to know, Skorobatsky, I'm sorry, I don't speak Ukrainian. But going back to historical sources and saying, you see, this is the proof, the objective historical truth, that one or another position is correct. And I put it to you that, we actually make up our histories, and we should make up good histories. And that's why we have history, is we can tell good stories about who we were and who we can be, and improve ourselves. Meaning history is not an objective science, not at all. The history is a humanistic endeavor. And it's that humanistic part that I find sort of lacking in these kinds of conversations. So the first part, why are we having these kinds of conversations? I put it to you that we've made the usual mistake of looking at Russia and Ukraine as regional questions with their own history, being separate from the history of the rest of the world. These are particular things, they speak particular languages, they have their own ethnic dances, they have their own foods, and all of these are reasons why we should only understand them as these particular ethnicities. But if you look at the stream of things, you know, going back to the 1990s, the breakup of the Soviet Union, the creation of these countries are born into a particular historical moment which the rest of the world was sharing. What happened in the 1990s? You know, sort of it was the breakup of the Soviet Union, the destatization of two very large economies, and the crumbling of social services, which created a social crisis, which is still with us. These are two countries which share something. And what they both share is a serious social crisis. The social crisis they share is a decline in standard of living. It's the lack of security. It's corrupt governments who capitalize on insecurities. It is the overly severe concentration of wealth. Their concentration of wealth, by the way, is no worse than ours, if you look at the numbers, percentage-wise and others in proportions. But because the wealth is smaller, it's felt much more by the lower orders of society. You have very high rates of unemployment in many of these places, very low wages, a very low standard of living. And in these conditions, you have governments who have been working along with the rest of that East European spectrum, along with governments beginning with the politics of neoliberalism in the West as well, of deliberately going about explaining and believing at the same time, and convincing a good part of the population why it is that government is not a good thing, that collective endeavors are not a good thing, and that wealth should be concentrated in private hands. Why it is that things that used to belong to everybody, because the system wasn't working, should now be taken and put into very few hands and exploited in order to enrich very few people. This is created, I mean, this is not rocket science, right? It creates a social crisis. So in these conditions, what do governments do in order to respond to the social crisis? Now, in both Ukraine and Russia, the responses are much more limited than in other countries. By this I mean that there is much less wealth to go around. In Ukraine, the crisis is more severe because there are no petrodollars to fall back on in order to pay for the state budget. And in Ukraine, the standard of living has never recovered from the breakup of the Soviet Union, per capita speaking. So what are your options? Do you introduce progressive taxation? No. That goes against all the current economic thinking, East and West. It's part of a generalized feeling that no, taxes should be more or less regressive, they should not go above a certain level. And the result is that we can't pay for our social services anymore. I mean, how do we pay for our schools for our children? You're asking the same questions that we're asking, in a more severe and acute way, mind you. How do I make sure that, you know, I can go into old age and have a pension that won't be squandered by somebody? You know, the real questions that we're also considering. And I think it is more severe in these two cases, and it's more severe in Eastern Europe in general. But it's on a spectrum with what we're experiencing ourselves. Well, what did we do when we didn't have solutions to our social crises? Because we don't plan to raise taxes. We don't plan to increase the state budget. We're not allowing ourselves to spend more, even though if we could. We're not going to tax more severely the upper strata of society. So what do we do? What do we fall back on? Well, let's talk about gains, right? For or against, it doesn't matter, as long as we're not talking about those other things. Let's talk about blacks. You know, let's talk about Latinos, immigrants, rapists. Let's talk about, this is what we do here, by the way. And why do we end up with someone like Trump? Because we've been preparing for Trump for 20 years, right? By talking in politics in these terms. That's why we have Trump. You know, thank you very much. We produced him. And Bernie Sanders, which is another response to a system which cannot fix itself. I'm not saying it's a better response. Actually, I do think it's a better response. But I'm saying, in other words, it's part and parcel of the same crisis that we're all facing and the lack of alternatives in the existing political structures and the existing social structures. Well, sometime in 2012, right around this time when Putin came to power, right around that time, Putin was getting advice from religious organizations in the United States and conservative organizations in the United States, and creating the Russian playbook, responding to a similar sort of thing. Oil prices are about to collapse. Russia has fewer possibilities internationally. It's being boxed in. And they begin to talk right around that time about LGBT, about gay propaganda, more things about Chechens were coming out at that point, immigrant workers from Central Asia, as the case may be. Meaning, we talk about Mexicans, they're talking about that kind of immigration. And, you know, I'm not saying that it's necessary that they don't believe what they're saying, but it has this convenience of not talking about our very real social issues. It's a real social crisis, which in the case of Russia and Ukraine is becoming more acute. Ours, you know, we went through a crisis in 2008. We've had some sort of, you know, a vague recovery ever since then, but for the most part, Russia and Ukraine cannot recover because they don't have the same resources in order to recover. And so we have this ongoing conversation about these sort of, you know, hot button, toxic political issues and social issues, but always avoiding that other question, which is that all of us together are facing social problems. All of us as Ukrainians, all of us as Russians, and in different ways all across Europe and all across the United States and Canada. So this politics, in other words, a division, does serve a certain purpose. And so we end up talking to each other as opposite ends, rather than as people who are sharing in some sort of human community organized within national states. And so the Ukrainian issue comes up. Well, the Ukrainian issue, it's quite obvious why the Ukrainian issue came up. Russia was again being boxed in. It had very few alternatives. It lost the game in Ukraine, but also because of the association agreement with the European Union, lost the game completely and had no options but to send the troops out. Right? There's no other way they can save face or save international credibility. That part's easy. But then it's extended and it's protracted. It becomes a 24-hour cable news conversation in Russia on all the stations about the Ukrainians this, the Ukrainians that, the fascists, the banderistas, and so on and so forth. So language, in other words, which is meant to sort of vilify and to delay. Ukrainians in turn, talking entirely in terms of Putin, as if he's the source of some sort of problem. And Putin is he's a problem in and of himself, but our problems run much deeper than poor Putin, right? everyone is taking the bait, in other words. So everybody agrees that no, our problems are not social problems, our problems are racial, ethnic, linguistic, geopolitical perhaps. And what does the rest of the world do when you open the New York Times, or you open the Guardian, or you open the, you turn on the television? Well, we take the bait. So we repeat. So that map, by the way, I think was perfectly fine. I understand how it was intended. It was meant as blue state, red state, right? But I understand it completely. But then it's also delivered as a sort of Russian versus Ukrainian. Not in your case, but others will perceive it that way, as Russian versus Ukrainian, in order to create these very sharp polar oppositions. And we go along with it, and I think so. You know, so what kind of way out would there be from this kind of politics? Because this kind of politics not only divides in very unhealthy ways, not only perpetuates the military conflict, but also avoids the fundamental questions that we are facing, and we refuse to talk about, because instead we're talking about who's more fascist, who's more anti-Semitic, who hates gays more, and so on and so forth, which we should talk about. But these things are also manufactured. You know, these things were not issues 5 years ago. They became issues, and they became issues in particular circumstances. What we need to be talking about is broad social questions and reintroduce the idea of a society and of a community, which is partly organized according to different nations. The Ukrainians have their problems, the Russians have their problems, but we also share certain things. And so in Ukraine, the kinds of issues of poverty, of inequality, of insecurity, of increased mortality rates, all of these things are problems are shared across on both sides of the border. It won't do to talk about their problems are their problems and our problems are our problems. These are shared problems. And you can look at it as a global spectrum as well. So the Ukrainians and Russians will not look so peculiar if you begin to look at them according to these metrics. We become part of a shared spectrum. In terms of history, so what kind of history are we telling? Well, histories are things that we reach into our sources and we look at documents. And we pick out those things that we think are going to help us narrate a story which is plausible and also instructive and edifying. One of the silliest conversations we've been having recently is Ukraine really a country? Or is Ukraine really a nation? Of course Ukraine's a nation. What are we talking about? Are we even going to start arguing about this now? But it's not enough to simply say that Ukraine is a nation. I'd like to know what kind of nation, right? So it's an independent state, but an independent state that does what? And that's the same thing with the Russian government. Yes, Russia is a great power, but a great power doing what great things? Meaning there has to be some sort of social content, and there has to be some sort of moral fiber to these nations. So it's not enough for me to say, Russia is a great power, Ukraine is an independent state, and has a long history. All of this is true. You can make the case. But a long history of doing what? A long history of what kind of community? Is it the kind of community that we're talking about when we talk about the Zaporozhian Cossacks? Is that what we're talking about? Some sort of collectivism, some sort of shared identity, lack of firm rule from above? That would be a nice history. Yeah, we can use that one. But are we talking about Ukraine, which is about xenophobia, about racism? No. That one we should get rid of. And concoct a story which is beckoning toward a different kind of future at the same time. Same thing with Russia. When it comes to Russia, so Russia's a great power. Okay, I want to know what kind of great power. I want to know what it does. Right now, what I'd really like to see the Russian government take care of its own people. I'd like to see a Russian government which not only gives democratic rights, which I think is important, but also guarantees that everybody can feed their families, that everybody has health care. That's the kind of Russian government I'd like to see. When we talk about the independence of the one, the greatness of the other, we're distracting ourselves from those core issues about nations need to have content. And that content also has to be social, it seems to me. That's good enough.
Okay, we've had three wonderful presentations with some maybe implicit polemics in those presentations. Now it's your turn. Yes.
I think something needs to be said about Khrushchev's capricious giving of Crimea to Ukraine in 1954. I'm sure there had to be a lot of resentment from Russia about that for generations. And also the question of the snipers. I don't believe they've ever been identified. They could be Ukrainian, they could be Russian, they could be CIA, who knows? It would be the first time the CIA has provoked uprising somewhere. Also, the elections, as I understand, were scheduled to be held in Ukraine in December of that very year when the COVID spread. But they couldn't wait. They had to have it now. And I think one reason we had to have it now was because the activity of the NGOs in Ukraine, and we have the exposed telephone call of Victoria Nuland, that the Russians very cleverly released to the media, where she was saying, we want yachts, we want yachts, and he's our man, get him in. So we know the U.S. played a very important role there. And the very name Ukraine, because it means border, is in a sense unfortunate for a country that wants to be independent. And I'm neither Ukrainian nor Russian, I don't have a dog in this fight, but I think it would behoove us to look at this from that point of view as well.
Thank you, maybe.
We'll happy to take that on. There is no evidence whatsoever, zero evidence, that the opposition was involved in killing protesters on February 20th. My colleague, Ivan Kachanovsky, has spread this conspiracy theory, which is very beneficial to Russia. There's evidence, and it's sort of taken a hold, just as, you know, conspiracy theories about JFK, once that's out there, it'll never die, no matter what the evidence, and this is the case here. There is evidence that the opposition had guns. The opposition was not a peaceful opposition. They shot other police. But there is simply zero evidence that the opposition would be involved in killing other oppositions, i.e. responsible for the sniper massacre. And there's no reason to think it would. So I don't take it seriously at all. Why Khrushchev? You know, all borders are arbitrary, right? That's just the nature of history. There isn't some sort of God doesn't come up and say, this is Ukraine, this is Russia, these are human creations, and there's all sorts of chance and arbitrariness involved in them. It does not mean that they can just, that there isn't a huge danger in constantly moving them and that they aren't real, right? And so I think that's important. I mean, you know, there's a false story that Khrushchev was drunk when he gave this, appears to be wrong. But he was basically, I mean, I can talk about that, it was basically a political deal, and you know, he was trying to secure support in the Politburo. This was a kind of sort of way to sort of gain support of certain officials in the Soviet leadership, but it does not mean that that's not real.
Let me just add to that little element here, and first of all say that the annexation of Crimea was the first territorial annexation in Europe after the World War II. This was unprecedented. It was unprecedented in as much as it violated the letter of the 1994 Budapest Memorandum that was signed by Western powers with Russia and Ukraine in return for Ukraine agreeing to give up its nuclear arsenal. It also violated the bilateral agreement between Russia and Ukraine signed in 1997. Finally, if we're talking about the primacy of ownership, if we're talking about original inhabitants and the original stake of claim, then I think we should be talking about the Crimean Tatars. We have even more of a claim on the Crimean Peninsula. And in light of that, I'd like to mention that right now that community is being severely discriminated against, hounded into exile. Its leader is living in Kiev now. So I think if we are talking about, you know, that, then it should be the Crimean Tatars we should be talking about. In Russian, there's an expression, Chaba Karova Mychala, Avasha Malchala, those who speak Russian will understand.
Can you talk about the NGOs and the role of the West in the revolution?
Okay, so yeah, and I can talk about that. You know, so it's true, the U.S. has provided funding to NGOs, and, you know, and also for free and fair elections, there's been sort of election observers, you know, the United States has been involved. You know, but that is very different from saying that they somehow orchestrated the revolution. I can tell you, the opposition did not control the opposition, much less, you know, Obama. I mean, there's simply no evidence, you know. And furthermore, the NGOs were actually not really responsible for bringing the hundreds of thousands of people onto the streets. So even if you did control the, you know, NGOs, it doesn't mean that you create the revolution. Now, there was a survey done of participants of the protests, and they found that 10% had been directly mobilized by NGOs. 10%, teeny majority. 90% came spontaneously. So I have no way I could imagine how Obama, or even the most smartest analyst in the CIA, could somehow conjure up those millions. I mean, there's no, right? I think of causality, you have to think of causal mechanisms. I just can't think of how that would happen. I mean, this is a spontaneous. So, I think if all you had to do was fund a few NGOs and get a revolution, you know, we would be doing it constantly, and Russia would also be doing it constantly because they also had, you know, heavy involvement too. I think these kinds of events are very hard to control from the outside.
But I think it speaks to, you know, volumes about, you know, the intense propaganda effort that Putin has unleashed. You know, in being able to convince such a large, you know, probably at over 50% of the Russian population in these stories. You know, how that, you know, Western powers, the nefarious West, is behind every single event in Ukraine, and from the very beginning, behind Maidan, you ask it, I think I would say 7 out of 10 Russians would still heartily agree with that.
The problem is that the Europeans, I think the word still is, that they don't plan to let Ukraine join the European Union. That's still the word, I think. So they may give associate status and offer better trade relations, but it's not going to be the kind of, you know, pouring in of capital the way it is for an EU member. You know, the way they did for, you know, Slovakia, Czech Republic, and so on. So it still seems a little bleak, it seems to me.
But it seems to me that a lot of, I think, people mislead themselves thinking by joining the European Union, their standards of living will improve just because they join. And they heavily rely on the European Union, the US, for support, probably financial support. I think it's probably a mentality of people is totally wrong. I mean, democracy does not come by itself just because it's in the union. Democracy needs to sustain itself with a good economy, and, you know, good economy is basically the basis of democracy. If there is no economy, I mean, it's very likely that we're going to continue on being an independent state.
Yeah, I think part of the misleading, I think there were two kinds of misleading going back a few years. One of them was, I think a lot of Europeans just let themselves thinking of EU membership is just around the corner when it wasn't, and the Europeans, when asked, told them so. But the other misleading in which the Americans were complicit, I think, is that, Lucan, you'll have to weigh in here, but there was this, you know, giving the impression that the United States would back Ukraine against Russia, when in fact it wouldn't. There's a long history of the Americans doing this. I suspect it was a bit of that. But I don't know if you have anything more.
I don't think that was really an issue in the Ukrainian conflict, because it never really provoked Russia. I mean, this is actually very different from the Georgian conflict, where that was actually really the case with Georgia. I mean, Georgia really started the 2008 war.
I'm thinking of Newland on the Square.
Right? Yeah, absolutely. I mean, giving cookies was a really awful idea. And, the cookies were really good. But,
it fed the revolution.
Yeah, fed the. But, you know, in Ukraine, John McCain gave a speech, and I think that was unfortunate. I mean, the sort of, symbolism and I think that's right. I mean, I think no one at that point really expected this was before Russia invaded. But I thought that was a mistake. I agree. But I'm not sure how much sort of causal importance that had in terms of shaping the conflict. I mean, I think, you know, people talk about that, but there really wasn't that. I mean, believe me, it's Obama, guys. I mean, this is a guy who's terrified about intervening. You know, he's very cautious. I mean, this is not George W. Bush. So yeah, it's very implausible to me that, you know, that the U.S. played such much of an active role.
No, I don't think it played an active role, but right. I mean, there was a perception that they allowed to stand.
Having Bandera portrayed, and, you know, it's one of many mistakes. But I think part of that actually came from my talk, which is that there was this wrong perception that Euromaidan represented Ukraine, and I think that was simply wrong. I mean, I wish it was the case. I mean, given the choice, I would have chosen, but I think it's just empirically wrong, and that there was this sense that this was all Ukrainians, or they would find, you know, a couple of students from Dnipropetrovsk and Russian speakers, and, oh, this is all Ukraine. But you just look at the data, it's just very clear it was not all Ukraine. And I think that was also the big mistake, you know, because Ukrainians did not want to admit that this was actually, Ukraine was actually divided on Europe, and I think that was part of the reason which allowed, you know, convinced people like Newland they could sort of safely go out into the square, and that these were actually represented all of Ukraine. So I think that was...
But also do not discount this, you know, 1,000-strong demonstrations of 5,000 to 10,000 in support of the Euromaidan that took place in the eastern cities like Donetsk, that were happening there, but then the thugs flooded in and bussed in across the border by Russians and dispersed them because they were armed and they were ready to fight. So, you know, that's also...
Right, but, you know, obviously there was far more in the West. There was a really, as I saw numbers, profoundly a regionalized, you know, it's just the empirical of the reality. I mean, you know, these were much smaller. I mean, I'm not, you know, this is, it's neither good nor bad, it's just the empirical reality. And I think, you know, if you're the government of the United States, you have to, you know, have to be cognizant much more than we are. I mean, I think there's a, you know, there's a very strong Ukrainian contingent in the U.S. State Department and stuff that sort of presents one side of the Ukrainian issues, and I think there's sort of less of an awareness, you know, until recently of the sort of all Ukraine.
So, before we bring this conversation to an end, I wanted to ask the panelists whether they have any final closing thoughts with which they want us to leave this room.
Can I just respond to your, I thought it was very interesting what you said, Yanni. And I'm basically of two minds. I mean, I totally agree with your impulse, and I, you know, obviously share ideologically. I mean, I think that, you know, in a sense, these identity issues are a distraction. And I would wish people would sort of be more, that, you know, what's the matter with Kansas? I wish, you know, they would understand, you know, the sort of questions of redistribution sort of, in a sense, are much more important. At the same time, I guess I worry that it's a little sort of verges on being patronizing, and so it's that that people are very passionate about abortion, and I'm of two minds. And so to sort of say, well, you know, that's not important, you know, what you should really worry about is the fact that you know you don't have any health care, and you know I would agree, but you know at the same time, you know, democracy is probably about people decide for themselves what they think are the important issues, and I worry that, you know, if we simply sort of dismiss them and sort of then we'll, you know, for one, we'll never sort of engage because people do feel very passionately about these things. So in a sense, you do have to kind of recognize that you can't just sort of push it away. But.
Yeah, I'm of one mind about this.
Okay.
So I mean, because, you know, we can have a conversation about abortion, but it wipes out everything, every other conversation. Abortion is a serious issue and should be spoken about. But it prevents us from having other conversations. And when it becomes a replacement for other conversations, that's what bothers me. And when you end up electing candidates for office based on that one issue, at the expense of everything else, it's a very poor people are voting for people who don't represent theirs at all. Then I think something's wrong. And I'm not being patronizing to them. I'm telling them that they're stupid, right? Outright, meaning to their faces. Right? So, I mean, I want to argue with them. Yeah. You're being a complete idiot, you're going to see it, and I want to have the conversation. So that's not patronizing, it's telling them I want to debate you on this.
I agree, but you know, typically speaking, if you call someone stupid, it's not going to sort of,
it's works.
Not going to be a very effective political strategy.
No, it can work, really. I've done it.
Well, we'll talk about that later.
But it is also a fact that, you know, those passions, you know, are not entirely bottom-up phenomenon. Politicians in Ukraine, essentially in the last 25 years, politicians have been evolving them very systematically to precisely distract.
Yeah, although, but it's not accidental that they raise them. It's because people respond to them. There is a reason because why did they bring up these issues? Because people respond to them. So, you know, you could say, well, this is all the elite's fault, maybe, but, you know, people do try to sort of, you know, come up with purely redistributionist messages. For some reason, you know, oftentimes that's not working. So it's not a completely, I resist the sort of complete sort of, this kind of top-down story that, you know, these are all things imposed on people. But people, you know, people do have agency, and I guess I worry, I'm not saying you're saying that, but I do worry that sort of this sort of notion of people as purely objects of the elite's manipulation, and I worry that, you know,
But actually, I was saying something like that.
Okay, exactly, there you go. Well, I guess, but at least you didn't call me stupid, so.
So people are complicated, right? They have all sorts of considerations. They can view themselves in multiple ways. And so, you know, one group comes to them and says, you should view yourself only in terms of this one issue, and your whole identity depends on that. But then someone else comes along and says, you know, there's this other aspect of you that you also care about. And we can have a conversation on that basis. Yeah.
But there was in the South. I mean, you did have a real left in the South. And what happened? I mean, why would that go away? It wasn't because elites were saying, you know, that we're saying, you know, talking about redistribution. The question is, like, people, you know, it's not like people stop talking about redistribution, you know, it's because you have more rights. I mean, so I'm not sure, I don't think it's quite as simple as simply, telling people.
You tell the anti-abortion, but you tell them, listen, you know, you're anti-abortion, fine, that's nice. You're very respectfully, fine. Now you have to put together social services to pay for those babies that you're bringing into the world, right? They're going to agree. They do.
Great. On that very note, I think we can close out today's discussion. I think we did not smooth all the edges or come to a consensus view, but we'll be leaving this room a lot more calm than we came in. Thank you.